Namaskaram. Lal Salam Yechury Lake Swagadam. Savisheshamaya Peribadiana, Lal Salam Yechury. CPM General Secretary I Vindam Tanakapata, Sri Yechury Maite, Uri Parambragada Abimukatende Apurte, Uru Artava title Samadrim Indiana, Ive the Yangal Urikanal. Sobhavika Maitum, Uri Victor Chodingal Kapurte, Vitista. Abiprayangal, E. Fortileki, Uiran Mendiana, E. Peribadi, E. Rubatil Jangal, Asutran Jirik. Vadare Sardhemai panel, an enlightened panel, and Dr. P.J. Alexander. And second is my good friend, Mr. B. Unnikrishnan. Jacob George. Saraswati Nagara. Dr. J. Prabhat. Then, obviously, Dr. Jadeng Gurikal. And also, we have a select audience. So, let us formally start the program, Lal Salam. Who should be the opening spokesperson or the opening batsman here? You will do it.
Yes.
Yeah. All unpleasant things are
done. A conventional misunderstanding
about the police.
I am not part of that culture.
Or the understanding about the police.
I just want to congratulate you for getting elected for the second
time.
Sir.
Thank you very much.
I also want to congratulate you on taking a political line which has set adrift a lot of anxiety among people like us.
Thank you.
There is a saying in Malayalam, a couplet. Sammaninado oru vaidi verunneram, vaavanvar thangal chernu nyayam. When you have an enemy who is trying to destroy whatever we tried to build in the last about 60, 70 years, people should come together, stand together, and fight together, and resist together. I hope your new policy will take this hope of ours forward. And I wish you all the best.
I always thought that we should be more afraid of retired police officers than the existing ones.
Same, same.
But now you put me at rest because of the question that sentiments you have expressed.
Are you sitting in an embarrassing spot now after this question?
No. It's absolutely. I mean, that's what we debated for the last 3 days in the party congress. And I think we came to a very informed decision on the basis of. That's why when people say, who won, you won or they won, I said, only one winner in our party, and that is the party has won. I think our commitment to the country and to the people, that we have to get rid of this challenges that are being posed, multifold challenges that the present government is getting posed, in order to advance whatever we want to achieve for the future. We have our idea what India should be in the future. Others may have other ideas, but even for all of us to move forward, it's necessary to get rid of this regime and the onslaughts they're mounting.
I think he's much more influenced because of the media reports that have come out in Kerala press. So much of things were happening in Hyderabad. You were holding somebody's throat, somebody was holding your throat. I think, were you, I mean, driven by such media reports?
No.
Dr. Rajan Gurikar, what could be your pick on, I mean, when you are having an interaction with Comrade Sitaram Yechury?
One major problem that worries me is what is called functional autocracy, which is silently in the making. Nobody is able to notice it. This is a clear indication. Any Marxist would know this. Theoretically, late capitalism would require immediate decisions. Capitalism cannot wait. And gone are the days that capitalism can adjust with bourgeois democracy. Now it needs full de facto kind of control, that kind of a state system. And the crony state capitalist system is operating through this, what I call functional autocracy.
Absolutely, right, sir. Because what is happening, you see, take instances at various levels. You were talking only of matters concerning economic matters of investments, of finances, of funds being released. But look at it in the larger picture. What is happening is the undermining of your entire constitutional order.
Yes.
Today, if you look at it, let's take the last three instances. You have more than 50 members of the Lok Sabha standing up saying that they want to move a motion of no confidence. Yes. The parliament is not allowed to function, and that doesn't come. You have more than 50 members of the Rajya Sabha signing an impeachment motion. And according to the constitution that you read out, it is there in the provision, the presiding officer's job is nothing else except to inquire to ensure that the number of signatures and the validity of the signatures. Once that is there, it is bound by the constitution to give it to an inquiry committee. And if the inquiry committee says this is baseless, then reject it. But before going through that process, he arrogates the rights to himself. Second instance. Today what happened? To Justice Joseph's appointment?
Yes.
The collegium gives the names. The government disagrees, sends it back to the collegium. Collegium sends it back with the same names. And now the government says, no, we cannot appoint for various other reasons they give. And the standard story is, but the earlier governments also did something like this. That wrong doesn't make this correct. And apart from that, you see with impunity, the system is being bypassed. Sardar Patel once defined the Indian civil service. There was a big debate after independence whether we should still have that imperial, vertical civil service, etc.
Yes, yes.
And whether you should have that or not. Yeah. Then the Sardar, he defined it and defended. He said, we will take our political decisions, but the unity and the bedrock of the system functioning is the civil service, and this is the steel frame that keeps India united. The tragedy today, if you don't mind, the frame may be there, but it's hollow steel frame. Actually, and that is what is happening. That is why what you're talking of functional autocracy is a politician, bureaucrat, businessman, nexus. And that is what is crony capitalism at the worst. Otherwise, how can you tell me? I just cannot understand. How can the Prime Minister of a country say, I will not tell you who are the people traveling with me when I go abroad in my plane? Can you imagine? How can he say, I won't tell you? And he says, I will not tell you what are the, I'm just being spent on the public exchequer. Our money, what we all pay in taxes. So that's why when today, very boastfully, this government claims we do not have middlemen. So I said, yes, of course you don't have middlemen. You are the middlemen.
Yes.
government is the middleman today.
You don't require anybody.
Which is making all this money. And that is the backbone of your functional autocracy. That when the government itself acts as the middleman, brokering deals, and in the global capitalist crisis that is continuing for more than a decade, the urge for maximizing profits is there. The avenues are limited. So this loot is one of the best and easiest opportunities. Like somebody was commenting, we never knew there were so many Modis in India. Yeah, Lalit Modi, Nirav Modi, now Narendra Modi, now we don't know how many more Modis will come. How many more loots will happen?
Only you can ask any sort of questions, okay. The most unpleasant questions. He handles unpleasant things in his movies also.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's not a question of being unpleasant or pleasant. It's much more than that. And
I do wish that you grill him also.
Dr. Gurukul was just talking about functional autocracy, but I'm more worried about autocracy as such. Which is sitting there at Delhi. And autocracy personified, and Mrs. Gandhi of the emergency days pales into insignificance when you compare with the present persona. So that is a very terrifying situation, and it is to an extent comforting that, CPM has adopted a political line which can function as a unifying force, and we are reminded of the first UPA government times. But this time, I think you will admit that the situation is much more complex, and the forces the party is looking forward to unify or, bring an understanding amongst them, varied in ideologies and driven by differences of all sorts. So, the joy that you feel that, oh, yeah, we are going to stand united is something which is also fraught with a fear that, you know, what may come after. And I would like to know what is your take
on that. You're right in the sense of the assessment. You see, you're right. I mean, in comparison to 2004, the situation is different at least in two very important counts. One, then what we were facing was that of the Vajpayee Advani duo. Now you have the Modi Amit Shah duo. Now there's a world of a difference between the two of them. However much, I mean, this is the tragic, mindset that is always done as fascism grows. You know, Vajpayee is better than Advani. Advani is better than Modi. Modi is better than Yogi Adityanath. The point is your common denominator keeps getting lower and lower.
What was the analogy from Mahabharata? You made some...
Whether it was Vajpayee Advani or it was... I was saying that all these people, they completely misuse the Ramayana for their political purposes and distort the whole thing in order to gain votes. And they forget the story of Mahabharata. Today they are saying that the Kauravas are an army of 100 brothers. So we are invincible, we'll fight and we'll destroy. That's what the Kauravas said in Mahabharata against the Pandavas. So anyway, that story apart, I keep asking people, they said, out of the 100 brothers, you're all very enlightened people. If you can just inform me at least, out of these 100 brothers, how many names of how many brothers do you know?
Saraswati must be knowing. You know other...
I'm sorry to disappoint you. I don't.
Duryodhan and Dushasan.
Yeah, that's about it.
Out of the 100 Kaurava brothers, the only names we know, Duryodhan, Dushasan. Of this entire Kaurava army of the BJP, the only two names we know, Narendra Modi and Amit Shah. And we saw how that army was defeated finally in the Mahabharata. So I keep drawing this analogy. But then the whole point is, one is that difference today is, it's much more, what you call, I would say exponentially, you know, much grown, the dangers. The second, in 2004, the left was much stronger to influence the policy direction than what we are today. Unfortunate, why? I mean, we have done our analysis, we'll correct it, I mean, in the final analysis. That's why I'm saying the final analysis, the answer to these people is only an alternative policy direction. And that alternative policy trajectory, it is the left and democratic forces who are best...
Congress is also very weak.
Yeah, Congress is also weak. The alternative left and democratic trajectory is what we are trying to build up, because unless that becomes stronger, you really can't resist this. So that is the primary objective. But the other objective that you are talking of, but remember, in 2004 also, with 145 seats, the Congress formed a government and lasted for 10 years now, actually, virtually, thing.
Yeah.
So the question is, it is possible. It is possible if you crystallize your objective and focus it on saying that at any rate, this government and these policies must go. We may not and will never have a perfectly alternative thing, except when we become much stronger and we are able to offer. That's what I believe. But in the absence of that, but things are happening. Whoever thought, let's say even a few months ago, that the SP and the BSP will come together in UP? Yeah. I mean, and you saw the by-election result, how the BJP was mauled in the elections. Whoever thought in Bihar, after the betrayal of Nitish Kumar and that Mahagathbandhan, that the RJD, and at the social level, not only political, at the social level is sort of a self-stimulated social engineering is happening, whereby the backward OBCs as well as the minorities, the Muslims, they are all coming together. And you saw that result in the by-election. So things are, I think, taking shape, because everybody else is not only a question of political survival. Like Mr. Alexander read out that constitution, every one of us, we take our oath on the constitution, we say this is what will protect, and now you see that whole order crumbling. So in order to defend that, I think better sense is prevailing, it will prevail, and I hope there will be some degree of...
I think only wanted to ask a supplementary question. If Amit Shah and
Narendra Modi could be the Duryodhana and Dushasana campaign. Who could be the Pandavas?
That's a genuine Brittas.
all that I can say, I mean all that I can say is don't ascribe any religious motive to it. All that I can say is our role will be that of Krishna the advisor. we will be the because we are always our patent, intellectual patent. Or intellectual property.
No, that. Actually, I am reminded about a comment made
is
by...
Is that outside support?
No, that's why... Comment, Sitaram, I am reminded about a comment made when we were sitting with Mammootty. And somebody was saying that despite the fact that you are having Sita and Ram with you, why couldn't you checkmate Narendra Modi? He's Sitaram, that's what I said.
I told them that what I require is Hanuman and his army. And it is that army that I'm trying to mobilize, that is the Indian people. When they come, and when they come into struggle on these issues, then of course we'll defeat them.
Question related to Unni questions. Dr. K.M. Panikkar, I think your erstwhile guru, and he's not well, but he really wanted to be part of the show, so he has asked a question, please.
There is a possibility of a multi-class mobilization of the people in this country today in the face of communal fascist upsurge. How this upsurge could be faced is perhaps the most important political question today. I am one of those who believe that it can be done only through multi-class mobilization. And I read your lectures and interviews recently as an expression of such a possibility in Indian politics. A possibility in which the left is not to dominate a popular mobilization, but to hegemonize it. Am I right in assuming that is your political view? If that is so, how do you, during the next 3 years, actualize this mobilization through popular struggles? It is easy to say that we must reach out to people, but in a society in which there are multiple contradictions, how it can be effected is a major political issue. I would like to know your views.
Today is Dr. Panikkar's 82nd birthday.
Oh,
okay. So I'd like to wish him the very best and also maintain his at the outset. As usual, a very perceptive comment. Because yes, at one level, the class unity and the unity of the exploited classes to change our system, to create a exploitation-less society is the ultimate objective of all communists. And that is what we all are working for. But in the process, in order to achieve that, we require conditions by which we will be able to have both the time and space to intensify people's struggles. Today, what this government is doing is denying the time and space, undercutting that opportunities, and therefore its removal is imperative to advance our revolutionary struggle forward. So like that, if that removal is imperative, then like Dr. Panikkar said, it has to be a multi-class coalition. Now, if it's going to be a multi-class coalition, it has to also be a multi-party combination. Now, multi-party combination need not necessarily be in terms of one united political formation, like a front or a alliance or a coalition. And that will never work in India. And therefore, what, in principle, what Dr. Panikkar says is absolutely correct. If you want to stop these forces, you require a multi-class coalition in class terms. In political terms, you will have to have a multi-party coming together, not necessarily as a single front, not like the Janata Party after Indira Gandhi, but as some sort of a combination which arose, let's say, in the 1990s and 2000. 1996, the United Front was formed after the elections, not before. 2004, the UPA was formed after the
election. Post-election.
Post-election, not before. And India, that is the reality. That is why if building a multi-class alliance in terms of a class movement, yes, on issues of democracy, on issues of secularism. We call ourselves a secular democratic republic. when democracy was under attack, we formed that multi-class coalition. A multi-party merger took place and Janata Party came. Today, secularism is in danger, and equally, democracy is also getting into danger. So something similar churning will and I think is already taking place in the Indian political system. That's why today it will be a big misnomer to talk in terms of, will you go with the Congress?
Okay.
Where will I go? In UP, what will I do going with the Congress? SP, BSP, if they get together, Congress is inconsequential, I am inconsequential. What is the meaning of that question in India? The whole of South, other than Karnataka.
So you can't think in terms of alliances.
Yeah. That is out of the question. The question is, you will have to pool your resources to ensure the common enemy is defeated.
In your own pockets of
it. In whichever pocket that are there. You know, suppose in Karnataka, what did we say? We are contesting 19 seats. And then we said in the rest of the seats, the objective is to defeat the BJP. Now who it is? That the concrete constituency-wise, we will decide. And that is how it will happen.
So the transfer of votes will happen smoothly? There won't be any hitches in between? Suppose you have got 5,000 followers?
Yeah. You see, transfer of vote becomes an important element when you actually have to convince people to transfer.
Yeah, campaign.
Now the campaign itself is that you have to get rid of these people.
Okay. One line.
How much mark you will give yourself for your past performance?
Yeah. I mean, your first day was the General Secretary. On a 1 to 10 scale, what would be the mark? I don't think that he can give the mark. Yeah.
If I give myself marks, I would have never passed in my life. I always want to score more.
Okay, your question.
Dosha
Sarasvati, you translate that. I don't know.
You have visited Kerala a number of times. You have a lot of Malayali friends. What, in your opinion, is the worst characteristic of Malayalis?
Worst characteristic? Uh-huh.
You're putting him in a trap. I don't think.
No, not a trap. Honestly speaking, that's a compliment to all of you. I'm trying to figure out what is worse in Malaya.
There are numerous things. I don't know. Okay, Jacob, you have the tendency to ask a lot of mischievous questions. Why don't you shoot one?
Yes,
now?
Yes. Yeah. Not that mischievous.
Yeah.
But Comrade Sitaram, we have been reading newspapers. Yes, you know. For the media in Kerala, CPM Party Congress is an important news. So all of our reporters come to Hyderabad, they report. So we have been reading that, you know, there is intense fight in between two streams of thoughts. Vis-a-vis the Congress relation. With respect to the Congress relation.
Yeah.
See, my question is, was it that the CPM could avoid a second historic blunder?
What would be the blunder? Going or not going?
Yeah, what was the blunder? That is the blunder. You need to define the blunder.
That is the point.
Is there a blunder at all? That's another
question. That is
one. Yeah. What is the blunder according to you? What was the blunder?
The historic blunder.
What is it?
That Jyoti Basu has mentioned.
Oh, he's coming back. He's going back to the history. So, I mean, looking back, he's saying that, I mean, judging the present situation, you did commit a blunder by not allowing Jyoti Basu to become the Prime Minister. Is that your question?
Yes.
Yeah, that's his question. Very simple. Yeah.
Well, that is now history. That is over. But after, from that history, we evaluated, we discussed in a party congress. I mean, we in fact voted in a party congress to say whether it's right or wrong. And then eventually here in Trivandrum, in 2000, we had a special congress to update our party program. And there in the party program, earlier, there was only a reference to state governments, like Bengal, Kerala, Tripura, I mean, when we had them. But then we amended that to say state and center. And then we said, if such a similar situation like what happened in 96 with Jyoti Basu case comes, the central committee of the day will take a decision based on the concrete situation of that time. So the chances of repeating that historical blunder, as you would call it, that's why I said, what is a blunder? Going in or not going in? That is now been limited with this sort of way, understanding we arrived at in the party program itself. That is our ultimate document, guideline. So that is, but I think that is a much, much later stage. Right now the task is to make sure that they don't return to power. Now they are employing everything under the sun. Every dirty trick.
See,
they have mastered the art of losing the elections but forming the government.
Yes.
They have done it in Goa, they have done it in Manipur, they have done it in now Bihar again by
Goa, they have done it.
Goa, yeah. Manipur, provincial.
Yeah. You are talking about principles, democracy, or the good policies of CPM as a leftist party in India. But see, pitted against you is a party which says that it is democratic, but it is not democratic. It will go to any extent. Even you can see what is happening with respect to the Justice K. Matthew in the Supreme Court. So that is a party which doesn't believe in democracy, freedom of press, even freedom of the people. Then how can you fight such a party sticking on to your own principles forever and ever?
No. I mean, we will stick on to our principles, and part of our principles is to get rid of this government.
That is the main principle.
So it is not as though that we are sticking on to principles and not getting rid of the government.
But they have got rid of you in Tripura.
That's a different story. But the question is that there are many states like Punjab where they were in government, they lost. Goa, they were in government, they lost. Later they made a government. That's a different matter.
Look, Comrade Sitaram, he wants you to take some unprincipled position. That's it. Is that what you want? What did you do?
No. Yeah, if the trend of the thought and logic is to say that situation today warrants you to be unprincipled also.
Yeah, that's what he meant.
My answer would be there's no need to be unprincipled at all. Situation on the basis of a principled position, we can still achieve that objective. And that is what we will do.
Saraswati, you have a supplementary to Jacob?
I have a different question altogether. Yeah. To shift the accent on what we were talking earlier. Congratulations in order on your re-election, yes. But what is disappointing is that, again, there are just two women in the Politburo. And look at this audience today. Look at the number of women here. I'm really disappointed that Kairali has not managed to find more women to sit in the audience.
I wanted to raise this topic. That's why I made the point that there is only one woman. Yeah.
Would you be taking a proactive stand to bring in more women? Because that is what the BJP is doing. They're mobilizing women at the grassroots and bringing them together. And that's playing a huge part in the way they approach the elections. And that's also that's their winning hand, in fact, in many small villages and in small neighborhoods. So would the CPM also be doing something like this to mobilize women and also to see that they reach positions of leadership within the party? And not be so much a male-dominated audience that we are seeing here today. Your comments?
Absolutely. I have 100% agreement with the sentiment that you have given. But if this is a reflection of Kerala society, then please admit that CPM is 200% better, no? We have at least two in the Politburo. you only one here.
One more thing.
It's a question of actually equipping the women in order to, and there are capable women, there's no doubt of that. I mean, I'm not disputing that at all. You have a society in which the CPM is also there, which we are fighting. We are fighting to change. There are women who are very, very capable, I mean, maybe more capable than men in many instances. But the question is that we are making all our efforts to try and see that more and more do come in. But we don't want to make symbolic points. We want to make in real terms. And that is happening. And if you look at it now, at lower below, and these are the leaders who will emerge tomorrow. Yeah.
May I add a supplementary question to that?
Yeah, please.
Because if you look at it, even in our times, there were so many vibrant young leaders in the SFI. You don't see any of them in active politics today in the top rings of the leadership.
Well, I was not firebrand, is it?
I didn't say that. I'm talking about the women even in Kerala. There were a lot of women leaders, but none of them really made it to the top. They seem to be missing somewhere, lost in the middle rings of the party. So would the party be doing some, and also there's an urgent need on the part of even some of the party leaders to be more sensitive to gender and to empowerment of women.
I entirely agree with you.
I do agree with you, sir.
I have my own generation. I can name you so many of these girl comrades then girl comrades who were all very, very active, bright, militant, powerful, etc. But as they grow up, and that is what I was telling you about the society in which we are growing up. Now that is a much larger battle. We are engaging in it. The patriarchal order that you have here is by itself the biggest dampener for providing the encouragement required for women to go beyond a certain Lakshman Rekha, so to speak, which is all nonsense. They can do everything else in terms of having a proper family life, everything, and still be active and continue to do their politics. That's perfectly possible. But that is the milieu we have to break. And there I'd like to, only request all of you, is not only the task of CPIM trying to fight that patriarchal system, it's the task of all of us.
All of us, yeah.
And until all of us join and fight this, we cannot stop this sort of a barrier that is created for women to go beyond a point. And mind you, this is a big philosophical debate. I don't know if you are a keen film goer. If you are, then Cuba used to, still does, produces some of the most amazing, films.
Movies.
And they do it, you would know.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
And there was a very famous director called Thomas Alia. He made, he would specialize in making films on how to perfect the socialist system. There was one of his hilarious films called The Death of the Bureaucrat. On how socialism has come, but the bureaucracy is not gone, how to change it. And there's this film, it's up to a point. Under socialism, women are equal. But he says, up to a point. No, you're equal, but you're only equal up to a point. After that point, it's no longer equal. That is where the patriarchy and the system comes in. And that is what has to be fought. And there my appeal is that every one of us in society who's progressive, who's forward-looking, will have to come forward and fight. It's not only the fight conducted by political parties, but it has to be a very enlightened, informed struggle that the Indian society has to lead. And there it's not men versus women. All of us together will have to do that.
One more question, please.
Indiyilulla nammada samskruta slogangal ippozhathe Indiyude political situation vachittu ഏത് സ്ലോഗനോടാണ് താങ്കൾക്ക് കമ്പയർ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്നത്?
Which slogan is apt for the current political situation?
The slogan is apt for the country.
പ്രഭാതോ അനവധാനത.
പ്രഭാതോ അനവധാനത.
പ്രഭാതോ, that is mistake, is carelessness. പ്രശാലദാദി പങ്കസ്യ ദൂരാദ സ്പർശനം വരം. Don't get into mud and spoil your feet. Keep away from there.
No, he has to get into the
mud. No.
Yes,
that is why.
He says that you can wash off later.
without entering into the mud, I can't do what I want to do, and I can't save the country.
So reject that.
Prabhash.
Speaking an earlier, while answering an earlier question, you hinted at the weakness of the left as of now, currently, compared to earlier kind of a thing. And my concern is also connected with that. See, the left is very strong as a political imagination, but as an electoral force, it's not that strong. My question is, how will you answer, or how will you try to plug this gap between left as an imagination and left as an electoral force?
Left as an imagination, left as a reality. I think there is a similar question which has been asked by eminent poet Sachidanandan. He is also unwell, but he really wanted to be part of this show, and he sent across his
club. Dear Sitaram, let me first of all congratulate you on your election to the secretaryship of the party. I have a few questions for you, which in some sense are questions to myself. The first is, how do you self-critically look at the gradual decline of the impact of the communist movement in general on the Indian people, or maybe within the country? Do you think that it has anything to do with the objective circumstances that obtain in the country, or it has something to do with certain failures in policy decisions, tactics and strategies? Secondly, do you think that the withdrawal of the CPIM, of the support it had given to the UPA one, has been at least one of the reasons for the gradual decline of the Indian National Congress in India, and also to some extent to the rise of the BJP to power? And thirdly, what are your own ideas about developing a stronger communist movement in India, and what are the kind of prospects that you see for the movement in India in future?
Comrade Sitaram, this has been one of the common questions which come up everywhere.
People have a left dream.
Then I think a similar question has been put across by Sachidanandan sir also. I mean, and he also specifically asked about the withdrawing support of the UPA one, and he really wants you to answer to that also. Yeah. you can give us a scoop if you want.
I wish you had a system where I could interact with Sachi also, or with Padigasa, but next time onwards, because very necessary for our country and society. Yes, sir, the question you are posing is absolutely very, very relevant. The question of left as imagination and left as reality. There is a big gap. Now, why did this gap come about? There are various factors. That is what Sajib was also asking. Is it your tactical blunders, or is there some other...
Failures.
Yeah, policy failures. But I'll also add one very important element, that is the structural changes. The reason why that left as an imagination will always remain strong is because it is the only philosophy that is at the same time liberating as well as at the same time scientific. I mean, you won't find any leftist who will not employ a scientific method of analysis to tell you this is what is happening. It's a combination of that science and that liberationary potential. I mean, that is what makes the left attractive, and that's always been the basic strength of the left ideology. But you see, why I add the structural things? Yes, the tactical things, 2004, I mean, that withdrawal of support, etc., I'll come to. But there is, ever since you had this, the collapse of the Soviet Union and the simultaneous upsurge and the advance and the aggression of globalization that happened, certain structural changes in capitalism itself had begun. It took some time to people to realize, because what was the objective? There's no longer here any danger for naked profit maximization. Naked profit maximization means that all services hitherto have been managed by the governments of various countries could be privatized for profit maximization. The first of the one to hit was education, followed by health. Now everything, I mean, from water to electricity to transport to everything is being privatized, except people say air. But now you come to cities like Delhi.
Even Bangalore, it is.
Bangalore, I mean, it's so polluted. Now the new thing that has started is what is, I believe somebody told me, is called the ozone bar.
Right.
So you pay 3,000 rupees and sit inside for 1 hour and breathe fresh oxygen. So air is also now, you know, privatized and used for profit. So in this process, education, which headed for the left ideology, the basic catchment area is the young minds. Now, no students union election in private colleges, no politics. I mean, the condition for your admission is that you will not take part in politics. So in my generation, the brightest of students attracted to the left ideology who would come. That whole structurally, you shifted it out. Now that is one example I'm giving. This is happening in every area. Now this example I'm giving is that this meant what? Yes, I self-critically admit, though we noticed this, the tactical positions that had to follow and how to rechange our methods of reaching out to the young. Then there was a gap. That I self-critically admit. Now that is the gap we are trying to now fulfill. We have. That is happening also. That is why you find that the left as imagination is actually gaining ground nowadays. Saying that this, after all, is the only answer. This is the alternative. So we made those correctives, but the gap that came in between, that is what reflected in the reality. Now, if one generation of, let's say, the young minds, the most active, the most the minds that contribute the most to your society is growing, if they are denied this exposure to the progressive left thought, it's not that they should join, but the very fact that they're exposed to the thought makes a big change to the system. JNU, everybody says left bastion, left bastion. I mean, I don't think, I mean, there's been anybody who spent longer or been working with JNU than with the students that I have done. But the largest proportion of IAS, IPS and your services are all contribution of JNU. Yeah. They don't join the communist movement or the party or the trade union. That's where they go. But when they go, they carry with them that progressive democratic consciousness, which is what builds our system. So the first point I was trying to say is the structural changes that were happening, there was a lag on the part of the left to understand these changes and how to respond. That has been overcome now, but the lag existed. And that gap that was there, I mean, that is something for which most of the other consequences are visible. Secondly, there was also the question of tactical positions and changes, what Sachidanandan was talking about. Now, our support to the UPA was based on the common minimum program. And we said that is the, I mean, as far as we are concerned, support is on that basis. Now, once the Congress Party transgressed that common minimum program, we were left with no option but to withdraw support. It's no longer as though we had a choice.
So it was not a tactical error as it is perceived by such.
Yeah, you see, that question was of the Indo-US nuclear deal.
Yeah, correct.
That was never part of the common minimum program. And the whole understanding was that you will stick to this program. To a large extent, they stuck to. And under the left pressure, all the constitutional rights you have in that Gobi have all been extended. Right to information. Rural employment, right. Education, right to information. Food security, information. All these are new rights that are not there in the constitution. These were all brought in as an extension of our, you know, empowering our people. So that part was there. But then this Indo-US nuclear deal that went in, and that was associated not only with nuclears, issue, but also with your foreign policy, with the global positioning, etc. That is something that they transgressed, the Congress. That left us with no option. And unfortunately, with Sachidanandan also, I want to inform him, people think that we withdrew support, therefore it happened. That we were forced to
Young man is ready to ask you a question, please.
As a government man in India, we all know that the political parties have their own view and the perspectives in their side. The main aim of a political party is to attain the power or to be ruled. And my question is that after winning, let's say, 2019 parliament election, whether your policy or strategy will be the same. Let's say you are planning to be a part, let's say, will be same or in the view.
You have predicted their victory already now?
Yeah, I wish so.
Good, thank you so much.
You will go beyond the perspective or the power to achieve the rules and all. Will you be in the same strategy or will you
same
policy to go. we are not going to deceive the people. We are very clear. What we commit, we are honest, we are straightforward, we are committed. And then what we tell the people, why we want them to vote for us, that's exactly what we'll follow. And there are so many complaints people tell us, why can't you be a little opportunistic? If you're not so rigid and follow what you say you'll follow, your government may have lasted longer.
Yeah, unprincipled.
But unprincipled.
Yes, it's about principles. Yes, again.